Today we will be discussing a special condition in the abdomen which is known as abdominal cocoon. So what is abdominal cocoon? It is total or partial encapsulation of the small bowel by fibrocartilaginous membrane with local inflammatory infiltrates leading to acute or chronic bowel obstruction. Histologically, peritoneum shows proliferation of the fibroconnective tissue, inflammatory infiltrates and dilated lymphatics. Multiple other names are there of this condition, such as peritonitis chronica fibrosa encapsulata, sclerosing encapsulating peritonitis, sclerosing peritonitis, encapsulating peritonitis, etc. Coming to the etiology, they are classified as either primary or secondary. In primary form, etiology is not exactly known, but various hypotheses are proposed. First of it is subclinical peritonitis. The patient may have some form of peritonitis which is not so florid, and there may not be some clinical presentation, and it may have led to the formation of a cocoon. The other is retrograde menstruation. In young girls, few years after the menarche, retrograde menstruation can occur inside the peritoneal cavity, which can incite chemical peritonitis. This is associated with viral peritonitis and it can lead to formation of a cocoon. Some congenital predisposition to this entity is also suspected and reported in view of some of the cases with greater omentum hypoplasia and mesenteric vessel malformations seen in few of these patients. Coming to the secondary causes and predispositions, the most common cause is drugs. Peritoneal dialysis with multiple drugs is one of the most important cause of abdominal cocoon formation. Intraperitoneal installation of drugs and chemotherapy, use of providone iodine for the abdominal washout, beta adrenergic blockers, pregnenolone which can incite peritoneal inflammation are also other important causes. Shunts and procedures such as VP shunt, peritoneal venous shunt in cirrhotics, leave-in shunt for the refractory ascites, previous abdominal surgery or peritonitis, liver transplantation and multiple other abdominal surgeries are also important cause. Some of the diseases which involves the peritoneum, such as tuberculosis, sarcoidosis, pelvic inflammatory disease, recurrent peritonitis, familial Mediterranean fever, SLE, protein S deficiency are also important cause of cocoon formation. Some of the tumors such as gastrointestinal malignancy, luteinized ovarian thecomas, leiomyomata of the uterus, endometriotic cysts or tumors of the ovary and dermoid cyst rupture which can also incite associated peritonitis can also lead to the formation of the abdominal cocoon. Coming to the clinical features, there are usually the features of recurrent acute, subacute or chronic small bowel obstruction. Recurrent abdominal pain, nausea and vomiting are usual presenting symptoms. The patient may also present with anorexia, weight loss, malnutrition, palpable abdominal mass and abdominal distension. This entity is common in tropics and mainly in the young adolescent females who are affected more. However, males, children, premenopausal females and persons in non-tropical areas are also affected by this entity. There are three types according to the extent of encasing membrane according to this particular reference. In type 1, the membrane encapsulates only the intestines and that too partially. In type 2, membrane encapsulates the intestine almost entirely and completely. Whereas in type 3, the membrane encapsulates the intestines entirely along with some another organs such as appendix, cecum, ascending colon, ovary, etc. Coming to the imaging features, on plain radiograph, features of bowel obstruction are seen with dilated bowel loops and air fluid levels. On barium studies, serpentine configuration of the dilated small bowel within the cocoon or confined region are seen. This leads to something called as cauliflower sign, and both proximal small bowel dilatation is seen with increased digestive time. On sonography, multiple confluent small bowel loops are seen with which are encased in thick hypoechoic membrane which is made visible by minimal ascites. Bowel arranged in concertina shape with narrow posterior base having the overall appearance of a cauliflower, membrane are not well seen in the absence of ascites. So this is typical cauliflower like appearance on sonography, and one can see a loculated appearance on barium studies with so-called cauliflower sign. On CT scan, which forms the mainstay of the diagnosis, one can see basically the signs of peritonitis, signs of bowel obstruction and multiple adhesions. So basically on CT scan one can see adherent small bowel loops encased within a thick enhancing peritoneal membrane. Demonstration of an enhancing peritoneal membrane is very important for this diagnosis. There can be retraction of the mesentery, which can lead to characteristic appearance of the tethered small bowel loops, which is called as gingerbread man sign. Root of the mesentery may also be sclerosed and retracted. There are signs of obstruction, agglutination and fixation of the intestinal lobes, mural thickening, ascites and local fluid collections, peritoneal thickening with enhancement, peritoneal intestinal mural calcification, and reactive adenopathy, which may be seen both in mesentery, retroperitoneum and other abdominopelvic regions. MRI also shows similar findings. This is a case of MRI in which we can see multiple small bowel lobes which are encased in a membrane-like structure. This is the first case. This is 17-year-old girl who came with abdominal distension and features of obstruction. Positive oral contrast was given and we can see this multiple small bowel loops which are encased in this is the membrane-like structure. So this is abdominal cocoon formation and one can see the proximal bowel loops are dilated. But the loops inside the cocoon do not get that much of opportunity to get dilated because they are bound by the encasing membrane. This is the second case, a 32-year-old man with pulmonary cox and pleural calcification. We can see the pleural calcifications here and also loss of lung volume on right side with multiple infiltrates in the lungs. This patient present with acute abdomen and CT scan showed small bowel loops encased by membrane with loculated ascites, mesenteric and retroperitoneal adenopathy, and surgery and subsequent histopathology confirmed Cox etiology. So what we can see is multiple small bowel loops which are encased in this membrane like structure here, here and here. This is the third case, a 28-year-old man with abdominal pain. Lower abdominal bowel loops are clumped here and one can see a partial membrane-like structure all around this. A minimal ascites and inflammatory reaction were also seen. One can see there are no abnormality seen on the abdominal angiogram. And on surgery, the diagnosis of cocoon was confirmed. Why we need to obtain the angiography? Because we need to differentiate from other differential diagnosis of clumped abdominal bowel loops such as malrotation and other entities which may show some abnormality on CT angiography. This is a fourth case, a 13-year-old girl which presented with abdominal pain since 1 month which increased over last 9 days. And CT scan shows multiple bowel loops which are encased by membrane. This is where the membrane and they produce something S-shaped. Here are the membranes and inflammatory changes and signs of peritonitis as well. Multiple mesenteric nodes were seen. Again, the angiogram was normal and findings of cocoon were confirmed at surgery. This is the fifth case, a 58-year-old lady who presented with encased colonic loops with internal feces also we can see. There is adjacent ascites and membrane-like structures all around. The uterus is pushed anteriorly. One can see this cocoon-like appearance and membrane is also seen here. This is the sixth case, a 22-year-old girl with abdominal pain and showing bowel encased by membrane. So these are the clump bowel loops and one can see this membrane all around. This is the membrane. This is the membrane. This patient, who is 59-year-old patient, who had chronic renal failure and he was put on chronic peritoneal dialysis with calcified cocoon. The walls of the membranes which forms the cocoon are calcified. And when you see calcified walls of the cocoon, it is more likely related to chronic peritoneal dialysis. This is the 10th case. We can see multiple clumped bowel loops with adjacent membrane. Here is also abdominal membrane, clump bowel loops. But what is more important is to see that there is defect in the anterior abdominal wall through which it opens externally and it is suggestive of enterocutaneous fistula formation. Abdominal cocoon can lead to intra-abdominal infections, enterocutaneous fistula formation, perforated bowel, bowel necrosis and gangrene formation. There are multiple differential diagnosis, usually the hallmark is that multiple clumped bowel loops are seen in this entity, which are encased by surrounding membrane. Similar appearance is sometimes seen in peritoneal encapsulation, which is a developmental anomaly where small bowel is encased in thin accessory membrane, which is derived from the yolk sac and during 12th week of gestation. It may be associated with midgut malrotation and vascular anomaly. So that's why it is important to also look at the mesenteric vessels and CT angiography in these patients. Unlike cocoon, these patients are mostly asymptomatic. They are found incidentally during the surgery and they are usually present late in life. Another differential diagnosis is internal hernias. Usually, only with the exception of left periduodenal hernia, most of these internal hernias do not have membrane around it, but they may show multiple displaced, crowded and engorged mesenteric vessels adjacent to multiple clumped bowel loops. So that may be confused with abdominal cocoon. The another entity called as chronic idiopathic intestinal pseudo-obstruction is also to be considered, and CT scan shows distinction of small and large bowel loops with no membrane-like sac. Luminous intussusception also do not show any adjacent membrane, and simple localized peritoneal adhesions also will be only localized and not completely around all the dilated bowel loops. Usually treatment is by stripping of the membrane, and with stripping intestinal release can be obtained. Subtotal excision of the membrane is also performed at times. At times enterolysis with small bowel intubation and bowel resection may have to be performed if part of the bowel is non-viable. Adjacent adhesolysis may be required in many cases. Exploratory reprotomy with post-operative medical treatment in patients with high perforative risk is also recommended. A special mention about treatment in patient with peritoneal dialysis. Incidence of peritoneal sclerosis in patients on peritoneal dialysis at 3, 5 and 8 years is reported at 0.3, 0.8 and 3.9%. So basically, incidence of peritoneal sclerosis increases in patients with peritoneal dialysis. Unlike other etiologies, cocoon formation in patients with peritoneal dialysis have poor prognosis with reported early deaths, and surgery carries high mortality in these patients. So basically, in conclusion, although the final diagnosis of abdominal cocoon is usually made based on operative and histopathological findings, radiologists should be aware of this entity to make a definitive preoperative diagnosis, which is best made on CT and sometimes on sonography and barium studies, and thus help in treatment of these patients. Thank you.